Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of your program Ask Huda. We will answer your questions and concerns in the light of the Quran and the sound Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. In order to do so, our phone numbers beginning with the area code 002-0238-555-248-249 and the email addresses are ask@huda.tv and gardens@huda.tv. Barakallahu feekum. Alhamdulillah, we didn't have any pending questions from the previous episode, yet we have, of course, a long list of email questions, so we can begin by tackling some by the time you start ringing in, inshallah. Sister Aida from United Arab Emirates says in her email question, I live and work here in the UAE without a mahram. If I return to my country, I will face terrible living conditions. Furthermore, I'm able to practice my deen here freely. Is it permissible for me to stay here without a mahram? When we answer similar questions, we look into the hukm, either from the Quran or the Sunnah. Then we look into the necessity, which may waive the ruling concerning this hukm. Let me give you an example away from this in order to comprehend what we mean. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ وَالْمُنْخَنِقَةُ وَالْمَوْقُوذَةُ وَالْمُتَرَدِّيَةُ وَالنَّطِيحَةُ. In this ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listed some items which are prohibited for the consumption by Muslims. Then, by the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنِ اضْطُرَّ فِي مَخْمَصَةٍ غَيْرَ مُتَجَانِفٍ لِإِثْمٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. In another ayah, فَمَنُ اضْطُرَ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ. And the two endings mean, and whoever is in a necessity, in a very severe condition, then with two conditions to guard necessity, which is غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ غَيْرَ مُتَجَانِفٍ لِإِثْمٍ, which means he does not desire the consumption of the haram. He doesn't like to eat pork. He doesn't like to drink wine. But he is or she is in a necessity. It's a matter of life or death. وَلَا عَادٍ يعني, they consume whatever they consume of the haram in order to survive. Then there is no blame on them. So this is the condition which makes the unlawful lawful necessity and with a limit. I will continue, inshallah, explaining this condition after taking the following calls. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Hamid from the KSA.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Dr. Salah.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you, Brother Hamid?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin. How are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Barakallahu feek.
I purchased some land several years ago for my children. And for so many years, I did not grow anything from this land.
Brother Hamid, I'm sorry, I can't hear you clearly.
Okay, I purchased some land for my children.
You purchased some land for your children, okay.
Yeah, just several years ago, and since then I did not grow anything out of it.
And you did not build on it?
Nothing, no, we did not plant any trees, any fruit or any crop on it.
Okay.
Now, next year, I want to just plant some trees on it. So, should I pay the zakah on the fruit? As I know that I have to pay the zakah on the fruit. How about the land, which I purchased several years ago for my children?
Okay.
Have I to pay zakah on that?
Jazakallahu khairan.
This is one thing. The second thing is my brother is bedridden for so many years. I want you to pray for him, please. Thank you so much. Jazakallah khair.
Barakallah fik, brother Hamid. May Allah bless you and your brother and your whole family. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Muhammad from Jordan.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Ask Huda.
Thank you. How are you doing, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking, Sister.
I have two questions, please.
Yeah?
Okay. I watched one of your programs today called Deceptions. And he was talking about the Quran and the Sunnah. That, and if I understood him correctly, he says that the Quran and the Sunnah are on the same level, that they are both from Allah to Muhammad, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and we have to do both of them, the Quran and the Sunnah. I understood that the Sunnah is third; it's obligatory. If that's correct, why do most of the people that I know, they say that the Sunnah is like it's optional? For example, when you tell them about growing a beard, they say, oh, that's Sunnah, like it's optional. Or wearing the niqab, they say, why are you wearing it? Oh, that's Sunnah, which is optional.
Mm.
Is the Sunnah fard? That's
okay.
My question.
I got your question, Sister.
Okay. My
Thank
second
you.
Question,
okay.
I'm not sure how I'm going to ask you this. I do not mean any disrespect towards you whatsoever, okay? But when you are asking someone a question regarding Islam, when they give an answer, you cannot just believe their answer. They have to have hadith or sunnah or something to back up their answer, correctly?
Absolutely.
Okay. So when I'm going to ask someone a question, it would have to be someone like from the, what do they call it in Arabic? The
Dalil.
Ulama. The high leaders, right? Okay. So this program asks Huda, anything that that you answer our questions, can we believe the answer is 100%? It's not your opinion. It's backed up by the ulama. Do you understand what I'm trying to ask?
Okay. Barakallah fiki.
Thanks.
I believe, Sister Muhammad, if you a regular viewer, you would definitely have an answer to the later question. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Hanif from United Arab Emirates.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking, Brother Hanif.
MashaAllah. Brother, I have a few questions.
Mm-hmm.
First question is, if a person is working in a mortgage company and that person process the mortgage papers and filing of the papers, is it halal or haram? Second question is...
Interest-based mortgage, right?
Yes. And working in a mortgage company and the person files the papers and documentation and processes the mortgage papers. So second question is, a person living in a West and... you know, it might be a bit hard for a person to find a job if the person is a practicing Muslim and doesn't shake hands with females. So is it allowed in that case to shake hands with females? Third question, in Dubai, if a person gets fired, that person gets some amount. It's called gratuity amount. Is it halal or haram? My last question is adopting a child. You know, parents who don't have children, are they allowed to adopt a child or not? Jazakallah, brother.
Wa jazakum, brother Hanif. Thank you so much. Sister Husna is next on the line from United Arab Emirates. Welcome to Ask Huda.
Hello.
Naam, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Actually, I have my relative who got married, but his wife was already pregnant 3 months. So is that nikah valid?
Okay, I would like for you to repeat your question. Who's married? Okay, I guess I got the question. I just wanted to confirm what I understood. Somebody get married while pregnant. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Abdullah from Egypt.
Assalamu alaikum. عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
شيخة, I'm sorry, I have some several questions.
نعم.
In Surah Al-Shura number 30, Ayah number 30, وَمَا أَصَابَكُمْ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُ عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. Can you please explain that to me? Is it it means that like the bad things which is happening to any one of us, is it from our deeds or is it something else?
Mm-hmm.
This is first. Second, if for example I had something bad happen to me and I can harm the person who did it for me, can I is it better to report the police or stuff like that, or as the Quran said, just forget and forgive?
Okay.
This is for now. I'm sorry, I can't remember.
Thank you, Sister Umm Abdullah. Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Ahlam from United Arab Emirates, welcome to Ask Huda.
Sorry, Sheikh, it's you. My name is Ahlam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. Proceed on, please.
May Allah grant you الجنة من غير حساب ومن غير عذاب يا شيخة. Really. You and me, by the way. Okay, I have three questions, please.
نعم.
Okay. I have been terminated illegally by my company in Dubai, and I'm going to get some good amount of money. So I want to know if that money is halal or haram. And if it's haram, may I use it to pay back the debts of my relatives and family and friends, by the way.
How did you get this good amount of money, Sister Ahlan?
Sorry?
How did you get this good amount of money? I mean, did you earn it from a job or what?
Basically, I was working with the company for 2 years and I have been terminated illegally.
Okay.
So
is it social security, retirement plan, or some sort of compensation an insurance?
I can't hear you, Sheikh.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Tell me again.
Okay. The payment that the company paid you towards the termination of your contract.
No, it's not termination of my contract. They terminated me before my contract and for illegal reason, no major reason.
So the company gave you the money willingly?
By law, they are supposed to. They didn't give it straightforward, but by the law, they have to give it to me. So we are still on the negotiation.
Okay, I understand. So the company handed the money to you either by law or a favor or a gift. Yani did not take it out of their knowledge. Rather, it was given to you by the company, right?
Yeah, they would give to me by the company by law. Otherwise, for sure, they will not give me if they are not obliged.
Okay, I think Brother Hanif from United Arab Emirates had his... fourth question was similar to it. And this payment is absolutely lawful. Yes, it is your right. You can enjoy it. It is 100% halal.
Alhamdulillah. He is my colleague, by the way, Brother Hanif.
I hope you did not get fired, both of you.
I hope no. He's leaving the country anyway. Okay, I'm sorry, Sheikh. I have a second question. During Ramadan, my sister in France, she's missing 10 days. 10 days of fasting every Ramadan. Are you here, Sheikh?
I'm listening, yes.
Yeah, sorry. So every Ramadan, my sister is missing 10 days of fasting because of her periods.
Yeah.
And now she has 30 days to make it up. So she's going to make them up. But is she, does she have to pay some money on top of it?
Okay. Was there a reason why she did not make it up on time, like between each two Ramadans? There is plenty of time, a whole year.
She has a whole year, but she's very, very lazy. And me and my mom, we are pushing her every year. And tomorrow becomes next month.
I hope she's not listening to you right now.
Sorry?
I hope she's not listening to you right now.
For sure not.
Okay.
And my third question, I'm very sorry to ask this kind of stuff, but basically,
yeah, go ahead.
My brother got married. He didn't have any relationship with us. He doesn't call my parents. He's focusing on his wife 100%. So my dad was quite suspicious, and unfortunately, he went to a kind of sihr, a kind of sorcerer, and this guy gave him 5 sheets of paper, and he said, listen, once your son visits you, or visits my mom, take these 5 sheets of paper and make them as bahur, and your son will be fine. So my mother was shocked, and me as well, and now we want to destroy these sheets of paper, and the question is, how can we destroy them? And my mom nowadays, she's in Tunisia, so how can she destroy them over there? And basically, the sihr was, is there as well. So I'm sorry to talk about it. I'm completely against this kind of method, but it's my dad, and sometimes...
Thank you, Sister Ahlam. Barakallah fiki. And I truly apologize to all the callers who are on the line. I really have to answer these pending questions first. I'll just take this one call because the sister has been waiting for so long. Sister Subia from the KSA. And I would request the callers to just put a hold on their calls until I answer these questions, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum, sister.
My questions.
Yeah, go ahead.
I've got a couple questions. The first one is... for instance, somebody's doing their salah, and they made sure that their hair and everything was covered during the salah, before the salah started. But when they finished their salah, they noticed that their hair was showing, you know, during part of the salah. So is their salah valid, or does that lady have to repeat her salah again?
Okay.
The second question is, sometimes, like, we're mothers, so sometimes, you know, we're praying in the house alone with our toddler who's walking around. And sometimes that toddler might have a dirty diaper, and he might walk in front of us or sit in front of us, or he's crying or something. We might have to pick him up in our salah, and we know that the diaper is dirty. So does that, should we, like, break our salah off and start again later, or what should we do in that case?
Okay. Thank you, Sister Subia.
Can I have another question?
Go ahead.
My last question is, could you please explain that, you know, it is in our aqidah that the Qur'an is not a creation of Allah. So I can't really understand that because, you know, everything other than Allah is His creation. So what does that really mean, that the Qur'an is not the creation of Allah?
Okay.
Okay. Jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakum. Thank you, sister. Barakallah fiqh. Okay, back to Sister Aida from United Arab Emirates, in traveling alone and working alone and without a mahram, and so on. So we spoke about the necessity and the conditions which would validate this necessity to break the rules or to waive the hukm, where the person will be eligible to consume even what is forbidden, to the point that he may eat pork or drink wine just to survive, or deal with riba or work for a conventional bank because it's a matter of life or death. There is no source of income whatsoever. If I didn't do it, I would just simply be homeless. I can't find a loan to do my operation or surgery or some very serious matters. Okay, so each person has to examine his or her conditions, whether it is that serious. يعني, can we call it darura, necessity or not? Because the rule says الضرورات تبيح المحظورات. Necessities make the Allah for lawful. But not openly, and not forever, and not for good. As we said, the ayat said, غير متجانف الإثم. Or غير باغ ولا عاد. I do not really desire, so I'm only doing that because that is the only option. I don't have any other options. And I do it with a limit. May Allah give you a good husband, so this way you don't have to travel alone without a mahram. Of course, the opinion which I provided is opinion of the vast majority of the fuqaha, based on several ahadith, sound ahadith, quoting the journey of a woman, sometimes a day and a night, sometimes 3 days and nights, sometimes without naming the period, such as when the Prophet ﷺ said, it is not permissible for a woman who believes in Allah and in the last day to travel alone without a mahram of hers, a male mahram of hers. Sister Muhammad from Jordan, in the class that she was attending, whatever, that she studied about the Quran and the Sunnah. And I would like to tell you that the Sunnah is as authoritative as the Quran exactly. Which Sunnah? We're talking about the profound Sunnah. The Sunnah which has been confirmed, it has been said or acted upon or approved by a Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It has the same authority like the Quran. And when we say the word the Sunnah, Umm Muhammad, it does not only refer to the rak'ahs that we pray before and after the prayers, nor does it only refer to drinking with the right hand or eating with your three fingers or entering the bathroom with the left foot and stepping out. These are all included under the bigger umbrella which is called the Sunnah. The Sunnah means every action, every saying, every approval of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some of which could be fard, some of which prohibition, which could be as haram as a prohibition which has been made by the Quran exactly. Some of which may abrogate the hukm of the Quran to that extent. That is the meaning of the authority of the Sunnah. Let me give you an example. In Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Al-Muharramatu min al-Nisa. حرمت عليكم أمهاتكم وبناتكم وأخواتكم وعماتكم وخالاتكم وبنات الأخ. The long ayah. Okay. Then in the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفَ. It is not permissible for you to marry simultaneously to two sisters, except what was done in the past. It will be forgiven, but it doesn't mean that you resume the marriage. No, you have to separate. Let go one of them. Okay. So the ayah finished with that. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I forbid marrying simultaneously a woman and her aunt, paternal or maternal. Look at the ayah, examine the ayah. It doesn't say anywhere in the ayah that it is not permissible for a person to marry a girl or a woman and her aunt, paternal or maternal, simultaneously. Does it? No, it doesn't. Look at it again. I want to scroll down to go to وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. Look, we're going down. Look at it. Okay. وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Great. So where is the term or the hukm which says it is not permissible to marry a girl and her aunt simultaneously at the same time? It does not exist in the Quran. So does it mean that it's halal? Because if it is not in the Quran, then it's not haram? Of course not. The Sunnah is as authoritative as the Quran. And that's why this is considered an addition, complementary hukm to the Quran. Another example. Does it say anywhere in the Quran that we have to give sadaqatul fitri after completing fasting in Ramadan, and when, and how much, and how, and to whom? It doesn't. It doesn't exist in the Quran. The word sadaqatul fitr does not exist. Allah speaks about zakah in general, and zakah on wealth, and perhaps crops. But zakatul fitri, we call it sadaqatul fitr. And a sadaqa consists of voluntary and mandatory charity. The mandatory one is az-zakah, which may be zakatul mal, zakah on crops, zakah, or zakatul fitr. And then the voluntary charity, which is every optional charity, extra, sadaqah. Okay? Who mandated sadaqatul fitr? Listen to the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas. فرض رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صدقة الفطر صاعا من طعام أو صاعا من بر أو صاعا من شعير على كل حر ذكر أو أنثى and so on من المسلمين. So that is not in the Quran. It is in the Sunnah. So when we say the Sunnah, we mean the ahkam which have been imposed or recommended by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now you get it? When some people ask whether this is Sunnah or a fard, in order to see whether I have to do it or not, it does not necessarily mean that negligence of the Sunnah. Rather, you know, I don't want to be judgmental of others. Yes, we have a lot of people who neglect the Sunnah. And by the way, those who are negligent of the Sunnah, they're pretty much negligent of the fard as well. And I can prove it. But we don't have time to discuss this in detail. But what I mean is, perhaps he's asking to know whether it is, like when somebody asks, is it haram to lie down on your stomach or is it mere makruh? That's a valid question. Is it haram to drink while standing or it is better to sit down while standing? That's a valid question, especially when you find in the Sunnah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually drank sometimes while standing. After performing tawaf, he asked Anas ibn Malik, he got him some zamzam water, and he was witnessed drinking while standing. So the prohibition was waived from the hurma into either dislikeness or it is better to sit down and stand, but it is also permissible to drink while standing. I hope you comprehended that. As far as your second question, alhamdulillah, it doesn't hurt our feeling. But once again, I would like to tell you, even before you started calling today, it's hard to say halal or haram without providing an evidence. But if you'd like to attend a comparative fiqh class, we'll be more than happy. Just sign in with Huda Academy and you'll get more in depth and details. You study qawa'id al-fiqh al-kulliyya, you study usul al-fiqh, the principles of jurisprudence, you study comparative fiqh. But to discuss, for instance, there is one question about the difference between al-jumhur and the Hanafi madhab in one mas'ala, which is the asr time. I literally can spend a whole segment or maybe the whole episode explaining the difference and why and based on what which opinion is. So for the sake of time, we'll provide the summary, what we call it, the nectar, al-rahiq. As long as we provided an evidence and as long as you heard the vast majority or there is a more right view. Sometimes a question like whether it is due upon a woman to pay zakah on her jewelry. And this is a matter which is disputed between the scholars. Imam Abu Hanifa is of the view that, yes, she should. Al-Jumhur, on the other hand, said, no, she doesn't have to. If I answer this question tens of times, and I provided an evidence, it would be sufficient to say the difference. And if you go to the Facebook page nowadays, you find actually each episode is provided with the details of the questions which have been asked and also the timing as well. It's coming soon with regards to the timing. You can just click on the time and that will take you to the question which is asked and answered on the video right away. So for the sake of time, we have to move forward. Barakallahu fikum. We'll take a short break and inshallah we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned.
Reading the Qur'an is a blessing. Understanding its translation is beautiful. But diving in depth and extracting pearls from it is simply amazing. Do they not ponder upon the Qur'an? Every week, inshallah, we will dig deep and reflect on the verses of the Qur'an one by one.
Qur'an in depth with Sheikh Ibrahim Zaidan, only on Huda TV.
يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا حي يا قيوم لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل
اللهم إني أسألك الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة اللهم إني أسألك الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله.
I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, alone without partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and messenger.
الجلال والإكرام يا حي يا قيوم لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. Brother Hamid from the KSA asked about a property which he purchased for his children. He did not utilize it before, but recently he started planting some trees and so on. So is there a zakah on that? Basically, only if he planted grains, for instance, and it reached the crops reached what is known as faith awsukh, then there is zakah from the crops whenever you collect or harvest the grains. And the zakah will be determined whether you irrigate the property manually or it was irrigated by the sky. So from your question, I understand that you're planting some trees, like fruits, for instance. So there is nothing in that. But if you make wealth, if you make money, like somebody utilized the property and it generated money in a way or another, then by the end of the lunar year, you add this money to the rest of your investment or saving and you pay zakah on the entire amount. Barakallahu feek, Brother Hamid from the KSA. Hanif from United Arab Emirates and also Sister Ahlam, they happen to be colleagues at the same firm. His question was, if a person works as a manager at a company, which is a mortgage company, and why Sayyid Hanif and Sister Ahlam are colleagues, and I wanted to emphasize that because now, after I answer their question, when I say that the amount which you collected upon being laid off is halal, now his question was, if somebody is working as a manager at a mortgage company, so the earning is already haram, then if we're talking about a compensation, it is also an extension of an earlier earning that you need to donate or give in a charity because your sole job or business is haram. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the sound hadith, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى آكِلَهُ وَمُؤْكِلَهُ وَكَاتِبَهُ وَشَاهِدَيْهِ. These are six items cursed in the riba. Al-riba itself. آكِلَهُ, the person who charges interest, which would be either an individual, the debtor, or a bank, or a mortgage company. وَمُؤْكِلَهُ, the person who actually pays interest, is also cursed. وَكَاتِبَهُ, you're talking about as a manager at a mortgage company. Okay, take this. كَاتِبَهُ, Al-Katib is writer. You said you just signed a contract. This is what the Prophet ﷺ said. وَكَاتِبَهُ, So interest, given, taken, writing the contract, signing the contract, وَشَاهِدَيْهِ, that is two, the two witnesses, because it is recommended to have two witnesses to witness the contract. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith which is narrated by Nu'man ibn Bashir, may Allah be pleased with him, أَشْهِدْ عَلَى هَذَا غَيْرِ فَإِنِّي لَأَشْهَدُ عَلَى زُورٍ. Find somebody else, I do not bear witness to falsehood. Okay? So I hope the answer is clear. And if this is the same company, then my answer before the break in the previous segment will be according to my answer right now. If the company itself is working in haram, actually in a major sin, then you collect this money and you get rid of it. Shaking hands with women. Well, again, if it is in the same company, then it's a mess. You know, what are you going to say to a woman who's wearing a miniskirt and all day approving or disapproving contracts, mortgage and haram and the interest rate, 6, no 8, no 9 and so on. It's an encyclopedia of haram, of gunah kabir, major sins. So when you say, no, ma'am, sorry, I don't shake hands, to whom? Come on. But if you're asking about what is the ruling on shaking hands with women who are not mahram, or a man or a woman shaking hands with a man who is not her mahram, it is absolutely forbidden. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said a very, very stern warning in a sound hadith in this regard. It will be better and easier for one to be hit by an iron needle in his head than shaking or touching the hand of a woman who is not lawful for him. So when somebody says, but somebody says it is okay as long as your intention is good, I'm not responsible. Today, we have people who literally make the haram as good as not the halal, wajib. We have seen people, you know, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, used to have a beautiful statement. He said, من كان مقتديا فليقتدي بمن مات فإن الحي لا تؤمن عليه فتنة. If you'd like to follow somebody, then follow those who died. Because if the person is still alive, he may be very righteous and he may change. He may become even all the extreme to the other side, the other direction. I'm following the encyclopedia of fatwa of some grand muftis and so on. Before he was appointed for the post, governmental post, where he has to sign in the name of the ruler or the governor, that the guy, mashallah, was giving the fatwa according to sunnah. He was asked about face veil. He said it's a fard, mandatory. Then when he was prepared for the job, he said it's recommended. It is not mandatory. Then all of a sudden, after he was appointed, he said it's haram. Absolutely haram. Then afterward, he said it's a bid'ah. And women should be banned from wearing. All of that had been said by the same person. And we are in a time where everything is recorded, audio, video, and on the websites. You cannot skip your statements. So what is the justification of the change? Nothing. No reference, no proof. Mere personal opinions. Wallahi, in one of his views, he was quoting Shakespeare. As he said so. So I said, subhanAllah, I didn't know that we should rely, Sister Muhammad from Jordan was talking about the Sunnah. Now we rely on Shakespeare to teach us our deen in their statements. So if you're asking me, the view is it is not permissible for a man to shake the hands of a woman, a hand of a woman who's not lawful to him. We'll take the phone calls, inshallah, in a little bit. As far as your fourth question, because we answered the third for you and Sister Ahlam, adoption, if you'd like to adopt a child, in a sense that, a couple could not have a child. The wife does not conceive. So they pick up a kid from an orphanage, and they raise the kid, keeping his last name as his. Muhammad, Ahmed, Ibrahim, whatever. He does not give him his own last name. He does not make him perceive that he is his biological son, or their biological son. You will be rewarded a tremendous reward. You will be with the Prophet ﷺ like these two fingers, very close to the Prophet ﷺ. But it is a major sin to give your name or last name to any person, even if you adopt a child. Adoption does not necessarily have to be by taking the child to your house, but you could sponsor the child, sponsor the whole family, and so on. Salaamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Let's take some calls. Brother Alaa from United Arab Emirates.
Salaamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum salaam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Yeah, my question is about, I have this insurance with a kind of Western company called Zurich for the last 2 years.
Mm.
It is insurance as well as kind of savings scheme. So if I don't claim, they will return my money, maybe depending on their share market and everything.
Mm.
So my question is this permissible for me? Because they invest in companies and it's not a kind of Sharia base. It's a Zurich, it's an international company, UK based. My other part of my question is that if I stop it, I'm with them for the last 2 years, but if I stop it now, I lose all my money because, you know, first 2 years are kind of, it goes nowhere. Then it starts from now. So my question is it halal for me to continue with it until at least I get my money back, and should I stop it kind of straight away?
Okay. Barakallah. This is, of course, a commercial insurance company. Obviously. Brother Bilal. Brother Ala, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes.
This is a commercial company, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Got your question. Barakallah feek. Umm Abdullah from Egypt. Very beautiful question. She asked about a verse of Surah Ash-Shura. It's verse number 30, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُ عَن كَثِيرٍ. Very beautiful ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whatever befalls you of a calamity, it is on account of what you've done, of evil, of course, of bad. So it's like some sort of compensation or recompense. Of course, for the believers, this is to waive and to remit some of their sins, because the calamities, the masa'ib, the disasters, the sickness, the diseases, if the person receives them patiently, with acceptance, they remove some of his sins. So it's actually, it's good. So speaking, it's good because it remits some of our sins. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that whatever befalls us is simply because of our own earning. And this is nothing compared to the rest of our bad doing, because he pardons a lot. But this is just simply a reminder. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud narrated that, إِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لَيُحْرَمُ الرِّزْقَ بِالذَّنْبِ يُصِيبُ. This is of the ayah. That a person may be deprived from a provision which was supposed to reach him because of a sin that he committed. A person may get in a car accident because he was gazing or staring at the beauty of a woman. Then he got in a car accident. We say, Alhamdulillah, maybe Allah wanted to remove some of your sins or remit the sin which you got in by getting in this car accident or saving you from a bigger sin or. Okay, so that is the meaning. Her second question is, if somebody did hurt her or do anything bad to her, that it is better to report him to the police or to pardon and forgive. In the same surah, in Surah Ash-Shura, in ayah number 40, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? وَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٍ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. يعني the punishment or the compensation of an evil deed is to be punished for a similar one. But whoever pardons and amends, then his reward would be whoever pardons and amends, his reward will be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means Allah would definitely reward him for being patient, for pardoning and forgiving and so on. But Allah says Allah likes not the wrongdoers, the oppressors. In the following ayah, Allah says, وَلَمَنِ انْتَصَرَ بَعْدَ ظُلْمِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَا عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ سَبِيلٍ. But whoever punishes the like of what he was hurt with, then there is no blame on them. He's just taking his right. Whoever defends himself by asking for a punishment for the person who have hurt him, like since you live in Egypt, there is a big misconception, which is, you know, the traffic system in Egypt is like it's a chaos. It's like a sheep market. Everybody drives whenever and wherever in each direction that they like and desire. Okay, the stop signs mean nothing more than Coca-Cola signs, like go. So if somebody crosses the traffic light and hits you, damage your vehicle, or even hurt you physically, then when you get off and you say, you need to fix my car, you say, how do you ask for such thing? It's not permissible. It is permissible. It is permissible. You hurt me, you affected me, you damaged my vehicle. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man atlafa shay'an fa'alayhi islahu. So they give precedence what is cultural over what is religious. Waived, dismissed. The shara is, it is very much legal that you damage something, you should encounter the cost of fixing that thing, and so on. There is even the yad in the jirahat, in wounding somebody, hurting him or her, which we call it the equality in punishment, or the law of al-qasas. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Amina from the USA. Assalamu alaikum.
Sheikh, I have two questions.
Naam, go ahead, Sister Amina, please.
Okay, my first question is, what exactly does it mean when Allah has placed a seal on somebody's heart?
Okay, go ahead.
And my second question is regarding the same question. If Allah has placed a seal on somebody's heart, that's the relative, they don't want to say, they don't want to do anything religious, they don't even want to talk about religion, how do you advise them and how do you make dua to bring them back to Islam?
Right. Tell you the truth, your second question, because of the echo, wasn't very much clear. We'll try to listen to the rerun because I assume it will not be possible to reach to your question. But inshallah, Azza wa Jalla, I promise to begin next episode by answering the pending questions, including yours, inshallah, Azza wa Jalla. Sister Ahlam from United Arab Emirates, her sister skipped fasting 10 days each Ramadan for 3 consecutive Ramadans because of her period. She did not have a valid reason not to make them up before the following Ramadan. There are many scholars of the earlier who require such person in such condition. Number one, to make up the missed days as long as they're physically fit, in addition to paying the fidya, the ransom, which is feeding one miskin for being lazy, the term that the sister have used. Others said, no, the ulli o al-qada, because there is no such reference. As far as your brother's case, and assuming that he is under magical spell, wallahi, I believe sometimes the human effect could be even much more powerful than the magical spell and the work of the shayateen. Especially if the person falls in love with a woman who tries to take him all alone to herself. So we really have to discuss this case and know some more details before saying, yeah, he's under magical spell and you need to do this or that. And keep making dua for him. May Allah guide him and bring him back to his family and make him uphold the ties of his kinship. And from your side, you try to call him every once in a while. Try to connect with him as much as you can. Sister Subia from KSA, with regards to the creation of the Quran, this is absolutely an understanding that opposes what the Quran says and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is a belief of deviant sects who do not belong to the Muslim Ummah. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I discussed this in details. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. This is one of the two references which I mentioned because we ran out of time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described himself as he speaks. So we have to affirm to Allah what he affirmed to himself. He speaks. And he said that the Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not create it in a sense he said to it be and it is. No, because then it is just a creation, like the rest of the creation of Allah. But rather the Quran is holy because Allah spoke it out. Allah said every word of it. Allah said every letter of it. And it is an honor for a person who recites the Quran, he is reading the word of Allah. And for the person who memorizes the Quran and furthermore gains an ijazah, we say that he got the ijazah from such and such, from such and such, all the way to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who got the Quran from Jibreel alayhi salam, who got the Quran from Allah the Almighty. What an honor, what a golden chain of narration. So it is not permissible whatsoever to say the Quran was created. And that is the reason. As I said, we did run out of time. Inshallah, answer Brother Ala and Amina next time. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفُرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيْدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.
Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate.